Yeah.
1 second, sir. Yes, sir, we can start.
Over to you, sir.
ठीक है, yes, sir, over to you, sir. Yeah.
Thank you, doctor. Dr. Tomar, you want
Yeah,
to
please.
introduce or?
Now, please go ahead, sir. Yeah.
Okay. Okay. So, welcome to my lecture 4, which is continuation of applications of radioisotopes in agriculture and food technology. And this part now deals with the preservation. So, the earlier part, the 3 lectures, you might have seen the contribution of the Department of Atomic Energy and use of radiation in improving crop varieties and getting better yield. And the second part is the contribution which are related to preservation of food, how to extend the shelf life and achieve various other objectives in food preservation. Now, food is a very important component of living life, or the life on this planet. It's important for everyone, so it's a basic necessity for sustaining life of any kind on Earth. Other thing is, the term you might have heard is of food security, which is actually nothing but availability of food to the masses, general public, and that too at affordable prices. So that is what is meant by food security. You know, it should be available in abundance, and also should be available at affordable prices. We have this Food Safety and Standards Act 2006, and where food has been defined very clearly as food, which means any substance, whether processed, partially processed, or unprocessed, which is intended for human consumption and includes primary food to the extent defined in clause ZK. So there is a clause there which defines what food is. But you know, there is something called primary food, and primary food in clause ZK means an article of food being a produce of agriculture, horticulture, animal husbandry, dairy, aquaculture, in its natural form, resulting from the growing, raising, cultivation, picking, harvesting, collection, or catching in the hands of a person other than a farmer or fisherman. So, you know, you see how clearly the law has kept farmer and fisherman out of this law or this act. So as long as the food is with farmer or a fisherman, as a catch in the hand of a fisherman, it is not amenable to the rules which are made under this FSS Act 2006. Actually, there are Food Safety and Standards Act rules and regulations which were made in 2011. There are certain foods like genetically modified or engineered food, or food containing such ingredients in infant food, packaged drinking water, alcoholic drink, chewing gum, and any substance including water used into the food during its manufacture, preparation, or treatment. So everything falls under this. So including irradiated food fall under the under this act. Does not include any animal feed, live animals, unless they are prepared or processed for placing on the market for human consumption. So it also includes animal feed. It doesn't include animal feed or live animals which are on hoof, which are actually mobile, and plants prior to harvesting, or drugs or medicinal products, cosmetics, narcotics, psychotropic substances, even though they are taken through oral route, but they will not be included as food. So currently, feed is out of the scope of these act rules, but food is, I mean, feed is very important in food chain, and many of the contaminants or toxins might be coming through animal feed. So there is a proposal of including feed and such substances also in the act. So these are things which are going on. Also, you know, provided that central government may declare by notification in the official gazette any other article as food for the purpose of this act. So as I've told you, for example, animal feed or cattle feed is one such thing which may be falling under this act if government wants. Now, irradiated food are also part of this act and the rules made there under. There is a section called Section 22, which has genetically modified foods, organic food, functional foods, proprietary foods, etc. And it says, save as otherwise provided under this act and regulations made there under, no person shall manufacture, distribute, sell, or import any novel food, genetically modified articles of food, irradiated food, organic foods, foods for special dietary uses, functional foods, nutraceuticals, health supplements, proprietary food, and such other articles of foods which the central government may notify in this behalf. So what it says is you cannot sell it, but you know, if government wants these foods to be sold, then there have to be regulations which have to be met, or they have to be satisfied. And therefore, for all these foods, there are separate regulations which have been made, and we'll come to it later on. But irradiated foods are right now very much part of the Food Safety and Standard Act rules. Now, coming to the need for preservation is very important, because you know there is a lot of food spoilage that you might have also seen around you. As per FAO and United Nations Environmental Program, nearly 30% of the world's agricultural land consuming an amount of water nearly three times the volume of Lake Geneva grows foods that is lost or wasted. So you can imagine how much food is wasted and how much water which goes into making this food is wasted. And it has huge environmental impact too. In India, 20 to 50% of the agriculture produce is lost every year due to inadequate post-harvest practices. This waste is also responsible for nearly 8% of the total world greenhouse gas emissions and nearly 14% of the total greenhouse gas emission from agriculture. So it's again huge. 8% of the total greenhouse gases are attributed to the food which is lost, and 14% of the total GHG emission from agriculture. So this is a huge, colossal loss that every year we undergo. It's economic loss as well as loss to environment. Besides that, we have, you know, high rate of population growth, rapid urbanization and industrialization, depletion of land and water resources, uncertain agroclimatic conditions, and inadequate post-harvest storage practices. So these are some of the additional factors which make impact food losses and food preservation. Now, there are several agents of food spoilage. Of course, there are larger pests like rodents and things like that, but where irradiation or other treatment may not have much control. But, you know, what can be controlled is, you know, spoilage by, say, insects and microbes. And here you see, or say, physiological spoilage. Now, if you look at the spoilage which is caused by insects, now agricultural commodities are always, you know, if you get any agricultural commodity at hand, will always be contaminated with certain eggs of storage insects, which you may not see. What you can see is probably, you know, if those eggs have hatched because of conducive conditions of temperature and humidity, they may develop into adults, and these are the adults or even the larvae which you are before, say, stage, one stage below adult. These larvae and adult, which you can see, they eat into these food material. Now, adult insects eat the commodity and also deposit uric acid as their excreta. So when these adults are growing, they produce uric acid, and therefore you can see, you know, whenever a food or a grain is infected with insects, it has a, you know, typical odor with which you can make out that whether it is a old grain, you know, because you can smell the presence of uric acid in it, severely affecting the quality of food material and often making it unfit for human consumption. So many times people remove these insects and larvae and have to consume this food, but you know, it is not advisable to use such material which is already contaminated with insect, adult insects and larvae. Then there are quarantine pests. Now, quarantine pests are actually, they again, they use the food as their say for propagating their life forms or as their food. Now, for example, you know, fruit flies or certain weevils, which normally you may not see in good fruits, but they are there. For example, there are weevils inside the stone of mango, which may come out and start feeding into it. So as a result, you know, this these foods become unfit for consumption. But more than that, you know, there is a stage when you don't right away see them, but you know, if they reach a country where these pests are not there, then you know, they can grow and spoil the vegetation in that country. So those, all those countries, they impose restrictions of on movement of many of the food products, especially fresh fruits and vegetables, getting into a country where they don't want to introduce the life forms coming from the country of their origin. So countries have very strict quarantine regulations. So for example, fruit flies, thrips, mites on fresh fruits and vegetables, cut flowers and other plant materials are likely to be infested with these kind of insect pests. So no agricultural commodity or plant material could be shipped abroad unless it meets the quarantine requirement of the importing country. Besides insects, the major groups are microbes. And in microbes, there are fungi, which affect appearance and taste, produce also mycotoxins. So fungi have, you know, dual issues. One is that they also spoil, but produce a lot of mycotoxins in it, and which may cause, you know, unknown health hazards to people who consume these fungal infested foods. There are yeasts which cause fermentation in many foods, and therefore you have this fermenting odors into it, affect flavor and taste. There are several bacteria which may grow in food material and cause putrid, rancid or fermented odors due to degradation of proteins, fats and other components of foods. Also produce bacterial toxins, and you know, they also cause spoilage. And you know, many times the spores of bacteria, which are not easily heat killed, so in sub-thermally processed products or cans, they may cause bloating of cans and spoilage of food. So these are the major groups of organisms which are targeted by food irradiation. Now, spoilage is one part which is very important. The other part is the foodborne illnesses. Many microorganisms are responsible for causing foodborne illnesses, and there are of course two types of foodborne illnesses, one which cause infection and other which cause intoxication. So you know, infections are when microorganisms grow inside the intestine, and after they grow in large number, there are infections like diarrhea, dysentery, and typhoid happening. Besides that, many microorganisms, they produce toxins in food material, for example, Clostridium botulinum toxin or botulin, Staph aureus toxins are there in many food products if they are not handled and prepared and kept at room temperature, not properly stored. So these microorganisms may produce, or bacteria particularly in this case, produce some toxins and which may be harmful to human beings who consume them. Besides bacteria causing infections and intoxications, you may have parasites and protozoa, which are actually higher organisms, but they exist as cysts in many of the food material, especially in case of foods which have not been handled properly, or which have not been handled properly, or in certain meat and meat products or fish, they may carry certain protozoa and parasites in their intestine or in their liver, or sometimes in the muscles of higher animals, which may pass on to the person if these foods are not properly cooked, or if they have not been treated to get rid of these parasites and protozoa. Now, I'm leaving here another group of microorganisms which may contaminate food, which are viruses. And I'm particularly, leaving it because radiation requirement for inactivation of viruses are very high, and most of the viruses are killed very easily by heat treatment. But certainly now these questions are being asked in relation to, say, coronavirus. Coronavirus can be killed by radiation. There are experiments to show that on surfaces, if you use high dose radiation, you may get rid of it. But for those foods where doses are very low, which cannot tolerate higher doses, it may not inactivate many viruses. So one can combine small doses of heat with radiation and get rid of the viruses very easily. Now, need to process food arise because of two reasons. One is the perishable nature of food, that's very important, because if food was so durable, we could have kept it, there would not have been much problem. But most of the food products, especially those food materials which have a higher moisture levels, they are much more amenable to perishability. So perishable nature of food depends on the type of food, the biochemistry and physiology of that food material, the bio burden that it has, the organisms or insects, eggs which it carries, the storage temperatures on which the food is kept, and also how the food is handled from right from, say, its harvesting to its processing stage, the physical damage that might occur, the processing, how you process, how you package becomes important. And when food is perishable, it is also accompanied by so many other problems. If food is perishable, when you cannot preserve perishable food, it threatens food security. You cannot carry food from its production center to a consumption center. Many times, it is loss of quality if some microorganisms grow on it, or some fungi grow on it. You may lose the quality in nutrition, also safety. If you consume some food which is already contaminated, it threatens food safety. threatens biosecurity. That's why quarantine treatment is required, because if you know, many of these microbes or insect pests, they grow on this food, they use it as food material, but if you transmit them or transfer them as a part of trade, then it may threaten biosecurity of another country, another place. Affects trade. Then there are this, you know, also the price stability is very important part, which is related to the perishability of food. So cycles of glut and scarcity are mostly related to the perishable nature of the product, because it returns, you cannot store food for a longer time. Farmers have to sell food at a lower rate to get rid of it. Therefore, you know, the growers may not get good returns. Instability of food is also because food is perishable, and of course there are related economic losses. So this is you know, not new. The perishability was known to people since you know, organized food production started, and you know, there was not that hunter-gatherer mode of food consumption changed. You know, earlier people used to do the same day hunting and eat, or same day find something and eat. But then when organized cultivation started, the agrarian economies started growing, then they realized that it is important to preserve food. And you know, since time immemorial, some of the conventional methods were developed. For example, sun drying, which is still you know, practiced, you know, almost all around the world, using salt as a preserving medium, using sugar as a preserving medium. Then people also brought in fermentation, because many of the fermented products were found to be good for health, and as a result you saw, for example, curd and some other fermented drinks which were discovered. So fermentation became one of the method of preserving food, keeping it for longer time. Then heating came into being, and heating is really the major part. You know, the thermal treatment for preservation of food is practiced in a big way today. But only problem with heating is that the original form and texture of food is no longer you know, there. It changes its form and texture. Although heating has several advantages, in, you know, many times food becomes more you know, tasty, or you know, it has better flavors after heating than without it. So there are good advantages as well as some of the disadvantages with heating, but it permanently changes the original form and texture of food material. Then refrigeration and freezing, which are again you know, quite prevalent all around the globe, and in certain country very well established freezing or cold chains have been established. In India also this coming up, and this is a major mode of preserving food in its original form, the way you want, you know, you can keep it. Then some chemical methods have been used, especially to get rid of insects and bacteria. For example, fumigation with methyl bromide, ethylene dibromide is very common. Phosphide is another very important fumigant which is used in godowns. But you know, there are problems with fumigants. They leave harmful residues on food. They are also hazardous to environment. As you can see, methyl bromide or ethylene dibromide, they are halogenated hydrocarbons. They react with ozone, and therefore they are ozone depleting agent, and therefore they are being phased out. But still, you know, some amount is still being used around the world. Although they were to be phased out by, I think, 2015, but still, I think it's a long way. Now, we will come to the radiation technology in particular, which is the subject of today's lecture. Now, you know, again, radiation, we have a long spectrum, as you can see, right from radio waves, microwaves, infrared, visible, ultraviolet, X-rays, gamma rays. And if you see, you know, some of these are purely non-ionizing. For example, visible light or infrared or microwave, ultraviolet, these are non-ionizing, but still they are being used in some way or the other in food industry. But we are not going to talk about application of non-ionizing radiation in this lecture, but only of ionizing radiations. You know, because we know that, you know, ionizing radiations have a lot of advantages over non-ionizing ones in terms of their high energy associated with short wavelengths, and also their deep penetration into material, so that their effectiveness is far more than say ultraviolet light or visible light. And also, you know, in case of infrared or microwaves, there is a increase in temperature associated with these radiations, which again you know, complicates the matter. And we are when we are using ionizing radiation, this is basically a non-thermal treatment. And when we are talking of ionizing radiation, we are talking basically the use of gamma rays or electrons, accelerated electrons, or X-rays. And if we are saying gamma rays, we are using just two sources of radioisotopes, sources of gamma rays. One is cesium-137, which has 0.66 million electron volt of energy associated with its gamma rays, and cobalt-60, which is around 1.33 million electron volts of energy, and electrons of 10 million electron volts, and X-rays 5 or 7.5 million electron volts of energy are used. Doses could be, you know, anyway from few kilograys, a few grays rather, to 25 kilograys. And as I told you in the previous lecture, 1 gray is 1 joule of energy absorbed in 1 kilogram of material. One thing which is, you know, very important to tell public in general is that any exposure to ionizing radiation of food, food when it is exposed to ionizing radiation in the doses given here and the energies which are given, in fact, these are the legal limits of energy, no radioactivity is induced in food materials because of their nature of their atoms and the energies which are used in this the processing. Once again here, for example, gamma rays from cobalt-60, it gives two photons, 1.33 and 1.17. Cesium-137, 0.66 MeV, accelerated electrons, 10 MeV, X-ray rays, when electrons are converted, you know, and they are converted using X-ray converters, which could be tungsten or, you know, any high-Z element can give you X-ray. But normally tungsten is used, and energies could be 5 or 7.5 MeV. In fact, our regulations permit up to 7.5 MeV if we are using tungsten as converter material. Now, coming to the applications of radiation processing, just for you know, ease of knowing what we are doing, everything depends on the dose, and it's the dose which actually gives you a required technical advantage. So we have divided these applications into three types. One is, for example, low dose applications, when doses given are less than 1 kilogram. When you apply such doses, you can achieve certain physiological benefits in certain food materials. For example, it can inhibit sprouting in potatoes and onion. You know, doses around say 100 to 200 gray are used for inhibition of sprouting in potato and onion. It can delay the ripening in certain fruits and vegetables. You know, the senescence in vegetables is reduced. Ripening of say bananas and mangoes is delayed. Insect infestation in stored grains, pulses, and their products like atta, besan, and suji, it can be achieved under these, you know, less than 1 kilogram doses. Destruction of parasites in meat and meat products, the parasites I was talking about, you know, some of the parasites like liver fluke or ascaris or certain helminths, these are, you know, tapeworms, for example, they can be easily killed applying say around 1 kilogram dose. Then we go to medium dose applications, which are applications between say 1 kilogram to 10 kilogram. These are typically, you know, applications which are used in pasteurization or equivalent of pasteurization. That means elimination of spoilage microbes in fresh fruits, meat, and poultry. Elimination of food pathogens in meat and poultry. So you can get rid of both spoilage organisms, as well as you can get rid of all pathogens there. So basically it takes care of all pathogens, but spoilage organisms may not be totally eliminated. Some spore forms may remain there. Excuse me. So as in pasteurization, for example, pasteurization of milk takes care of most of the pathogens, but still, you know, milk can be spoiled, because though some of the spoilage organisms are killed, but there are, you know, it's not totally sterilizing the product. So some organisms will be found there which eventually will spoil things, but it will certainly remove pathogens from the picture. Also, you know, around 10 kilogram, we can achieve hygienization of spices and herbs. So when you give a dose of 10 kilogram, you almost get rid of most of the microbes, but still it is not a sterile product. There will be organisms, maybe 100 to 1000 microbes per gram of material may still be there around. So that's why the process is called hygienization. It can also be achieved around 10 kilogram of dose. Then there are applications which are above 10 kilogram, and these applications are normally used on food materials for achieving sterilization. You know, almost getting rid of all microbial activity there, and you can get shelf stable foods without refrigeration in such products. You don't have to, for example, in certain ready to eat products, if you are sterilizing at high doses, even meat products at high doses at low temperature, you can keep these for a long time, maybe 2 to 3 years. And many of these products are used for preparing rations for astronauts. So these are sterile products, shelf stable products. So what radiation processing can do is, it can do several things. If you see this slide, which is very common, and it was prepared in BRC, but you can see it on the internet now. It's available to everyone. Now we can say that it is one process which has multiple uses. So you can see, depending on the dose, if you are using very small dose, maybe around 100 to 200 gray, you can get sprout inhibition in onion, potato, ginger, garlic, virtually any crop which is susceptible to germination, where sprouting is a problem, where there is quick sprouting with at high temperature and high humidity, there you can apply small doses and totally inhibit sprouting. Then on the other side, you have fruits, for example, banana, mangoes, and things like that. You can actually irradiate again around, say, 400 to 500 gray, even less, in some cases, maybe 300 to 500 gray. You can have multiple benefits. Not only you can delay the ripening in these fruits and vegetables, you can also kill the quarantine insect pests in fruits. So quarantine doses are less than 1 kilogray. And mostly, for example, export of mangoes to US has approved 400 gray treatment. So if the USDA has approved 400 gray, one can also use lower doses. It can get rid of all quarantine insect pests, including the weevil, which is there in the stone, as well as the fruit flies, which are there on the fruits. Besides, it can delay the ripening in these fruits. Then I told you that the other important application is insect disinfestation, which is in case of cereals, pulses, and dry fruits. Virtually in any material, if you want to get rid of insect pests, irradiation is the most effective treatment. Shelf life extension of chicken, meat, fish. So it's actually the pasteurization of all meat and meat products. You can get rid of the pathogens as well as extend the shelf life at the recommended storage temperature. Hygienization of spices and flesh foods again is another. So you can do several things by manipulating doses. Sorry. Now, again, working mode is same as I told you in the mutation breeding lecture, where one can achieve ionization, ejecting electrons from atoms, and those electrons actually directly affect the DNA by depositing the energy on DNA and other large molecules like RNA and proteins. And the other effect is through indirect effect, where water molecules are ionized, or radiolysis of water is carried out by these electrons. And so you get different types of radicals and ions, which indirectly affect these molecules, which are important for growth of these microbes and insects. And that's how these microbes, insects are killed, or inhibition of sprouting takes place, or delay in ripening takes place. It's basically because of these two, direct and indirect effects. Indirect effects happening because of radiolysis of water, which the radicals created there, like hydrogen radical, hydroxyl radical, superoxide radical, or the aqueous, all they indirectly affect the chemistry of the molecules which are there, and the direct effect by direct deposition of energy on the molecule and causing changes in DNA, as I told you in the earlier lectures. So mode of working is same, but in this case the target is the problematic insects which are there, which could be storage insects or quarantine insects. It could be microbes, which could be fungi or yeast or bacteria, or they can be parasites like helminths or protozoa. So those are the target, and that's how they get killed in the food material. At the doses which we recommend for treatment of food, the food material itself doesn't change its characters as much. That's why those doses are important. So we see to it that the doses which are applied to the food material don't change the characters or consumer requirement of these food material. Eventually, these foods are going to be processed and consumed. So, you know, there are no issues related to safety. But I'll come to that aspect a little later. So, what are the advantages of radiation processing of food? It's a physical, non-additive process causing minimal change in food. That's very important. You know, it keeps the nature of food intact. It doesn't impact the nature of food because it's a non-thermal treatment. It's highly effective compared to chemicals and fumigants, does not leave harmful residues in food, can be applied to bulk as well as pre-packaged food. That's very important advantage of radiation. That is, you can have the final packed product. You don't have to open and expose the product. So you can pack the product, even primary packing, you can put it a number of packages in a secondary carton. And even in a big master carton, you can keep these and get irradiated, as long as your conveyor and system is designed in a way that it can handle these loads. It's a cold process, preserves food in natural form, does not destroy heat labile aroma constituents of food. So again, very important thing, you know, like in spices, normally heating would take away the aroma constituents, but irradiation, being a cold process, the aroma of spices or of any other food will remain intact. The process is safe to workers and friendly to environment. So, you know, since irradiation is done in a very safe kind of irradiators, which are approved by Atomic Energy Regulatory Board, and most of the irradiation is done remotely through, you know, several after taking into account all the safety features, and you know, will prevent any exposure of a personal working personal in the plant. So all that, with those safety mechanisms, there is you know, hardly any report of any overexposure to a worker. And also, as I told you, you can get rid of it, you know, any irradiation plant does not emit any pollutant into the environment, gaseous or liquid. So it's you know, very safe. Of course, there are limitations of the technology in related to that. You know, you cannot pick up any food and irradiate and you know, use the technology, because you know, you have to actually see the amenability of any food. So you have to do some experiments in food in the laboratory to test the kind of doses which can be administered to a food material. That means whether food can tolerate that kind of dose for which, you know, you are applying irradiation. And you have to work out a good, I think, a good dose and effect combination to arrive at a right combination of dose and effect for any food material. So once you have done that experiment, then you have to scale it up in a facility, and then you know, you have to standardize other process parameters. As I told you, in case of say, if you are thinking of viruses to be inactivated, I told you, you may require higher doses, because viruses are literally a very small and dry material. So you may need very high doses to inactivate them, and you know, at low doses they may not be destroyed, but small use of heat treatment will take care of it. So that is another thing. Other part is, you know, it is also said that it is capital intensive, because you have to actually put in some amount of money. It is not a machine that you can buy and carry out irradiation. So you have to set up a plant which may need some capital and some land resources for setting up. So there is a cost associated with it. These are some of the limitations. Now, I'll just tell you something internationally, how things have moved since the discovery of X-rays in 1895 and radioactivity in 1896. In 1904, the first studies were carried out in MIT, where Samuel Prescott, who found that, you know, radiation are very effective in getting rid of bacteria. Immediately after this discovery in 1906, a patent was sought in UK for using radioactive isotopes to irradiate food by Appleby and Banks. In 18, a US patent to use X-rays for preservation of food was granted. In 1921, they found that trichinella in food, which is a parasite, can be eliminated with radiation. In 1930, there was a French patent on food irradiation. In again 1943, a lot of interest was generated on food preservation using radiation by US Army. So US Army funded a big study at MIT in 1943 for looking at the food preservation aspect of radiation processing. In fact, in 1951, US Atomic Energy Commission got in and started to coordinate these national research activities. In 1958, there was a first commercial irradiation facility which was started in Stuttgart in Germany, which you know, failed later on because of several reasons. Because, you know, there were a problem of getting radioisotopes with competitive prices. And, you know, the economics, because of economics, this facility was closed. In 1970, there was a big program called International Food Irradiation Project, which was started in Federal Research Center for Food Preservation in Karlsruhe in Germany. So this was actually a lot of work was done at this place, and a lot of safety studies were done related to irradiated food. You know, a lot of data around the world was generated on the safety of radiation processed foods. This data was actually, you know, studied by a committee called Joint Expert Committee on Food Irradiation, or JECFI, of FAO, IAEA, and WHO. So this was actually spearheaded by IAEA, FAO, and World Health Organization. And they found that, you know, there is no safety concerns, and but, you know, they were still conservative and allowed irradiation up to 10 kilogray of dose. Later on, of course, in 83, the IFIP, that is the this German facility, was closed down because all the end were achieved. Whatever it was set for was achieved, so they closed down this facility. But, you know, then in 1983, Codex Alimentarius Commission came into picture, and they actually drafted the standards, which are called general standards for irradiated foods at 10 kilogray. So this was, you know, like when this Codex General Standards were made for radiation processing of food, this opened it up for the rest of the world, use of this radiation without any inhibition. In 1984, there was an international consultative group on food irradiation, which was actually formed at IAEA and which was successor to this Karlsruhe facility called IFIP. In 98, European Commission also, agreed to allow irradiation for 8 categories of foods. Then in 97, again a committee was formed by FAO, IAEA, WHO, which was a joint study group which looked at the safety of high dose irradiation and recommended the lifting any upper dose limit. This earlier it was said that 10 kilogray dose should be the limit for application for food irradiation, but this committee recommended that there should not be any upper limit. If required, one can use higher doses, and that opened up for application of higher doses, especially for sterilization of food material, giving more than 10 kilogray. In fact, NASA some of the studies at MIT showed that even application up to 45 kilogray dose does not affect the safety aspect of food material. Then I'll also touch upon some Indian milestones. And as you can see here, it was 1954 that R&D in atomic energy began in India. Around 1958, there was this work on food irradiation started in India. Basically, the work till this point of time was being carried out using a reactor. At that time, we had Cyrus reactor. And with the commissioning of Cyrus reactor, work started on looking at effect of radiation on living materials, plant materials, including food. In 1967, there was this setting up of food irradiation processing laboratory and a food package irradiator at Bhabha Atomic Research Center. In 1974, there was a big commercial scale facility set up again at BRC called ISOMED, which was mainly for irradiation of medical products. So these were the two pioneering facilities which were set up by DAE to begin with. In 86, after seeing this, the first irradiation facility in public domain was set up in Shriram Industrial Institute in Delhi. This SARC irradiator is still functioning. In 2000, first technology demonstration unit for spices and dry ingredients at Navi Mumbai was set up, which is functioning, doing about 30 tons of spices per day. That is the capacity of the plant. Then in 2002, the first technology demonstration unit for agriculture products at Lasalgaon was started by the Food Technology Division, Bhabha Atomic Research Center. And this was the first facility to demonstrate use of radiation technology on agriculture products, and later on this was approved by US FDA for export of mangoes to US after quarantine treatment. After these technology demonstration units were set up by DAE, in 2004 this was first private entrepreneur which set up a facility called Organic Green Foods Limited in Kolkata. Thereafter, as I'll tell you later, that we have more than 20 plants which are doing radiation processing. They are set up by private entrepreneurs. As far as regulatory milestones are concerned, and for anything to be carried out in public domain or any processing to be done in public domain, we need very solid regulatory framework behind it. So in 1991, this atomic energy rules were amended, and these were called Atomic Energy Control of Irradiation of Food Rules, which were again amended in 1996. In 1994, we had this Prevention of Food Adulteration Act before the Food Safety and Standards Act came into existence in 2006. This was PFA Act, under which rules were there. So irradiation of food was included in these rules. And initially they approved for onion, potatoes and spices. And later on other articles of foods like wheat atta, rice and other things were included. In 2003, Ministry of Agriculture also amended quarantine regulations or plant quarantine regulations and included irradiation as a quarantine measure. In 2012, again, you know, a big exercise was done in Food Technology Division, and this all atomic energy radiation processing of food and allied products rules, which, you know, replaced earlier 1996 rules. And, you know, these were the rules which gave a wider canvas, you know, of irradiation. And this was based on the classes. So there were some 8 classes of food products which are actually created and which were recognized around the globe, and radiation doses for different technological objectives were provided in these rules. And after these were published, it took almost 4 years for absorbing these rules in food safety and standards regulations. So currently we have these classes, our atomic energy rules reflected in food safety and standards rules. Now, now these questions are not asked, but still for people who are not quite aware of this technology, they always raise this question of safety and wholesomeness. That is, and they were, you know, very pertinent questions to begin with in, say, 60s, 70s, and even 80s, I would say. But after Codex Alimentarius Commission or IAEA, WHO, FAO cleared it, these questions are not asked. But as I was telling you, there's a lot of data which is there, and even books are there, you know, which endorse the safety of radiation processed food products. There are, you know, studies which show no adverse effect reported, for example, related to radiological safety, you know, whether there will be any induction of radioactivity in food exposed to radiation at the doses which are given and at the energies of the radiation that we use. So there is no evidence of any adverse effects. Safety of chemical changes, there are huge number of studies. Safety of any microbiological changes, the nutritional adequacy, whether it impacts nutrition, and if it impacts, whether that impact will be significant or will be tolerable. And to cap it up, there have been animal feeding studies. You know, there are multi-generation chrome acute as well as chronic animal feeding studies done, and no adverse effects have been seen in several generations of animals, and many of these studies have been done in BRC also. There have been studies on human volunteer, that means human volunteers were fed these food for a number of months, and no adverse effects were seen. In fact, astronauts and cosmonauts have been carrying irradiated food on space missions, so that endorses their safety. Further, the safety has also been endorsed by FAO, IAEA, WHO in 1981, 1994, 1999, Codex Alimentarius Commission in 1983 and 2003, WTO and GATT, you know, World Trade Organization, earlier General Agreement for Tariff and Trade, they allow radiation processing if properly declared, you know, and then if it is carried out in facilities which are approved by the importer. IPPC, that is International Plant Protection Convention 2003, USFDA, USDA, AFIS, that is AFIS's Animal Plant Health Inspection Service of US Department of Agriculture, EFSA, that is European Food Safety Authority, many of the professional scientific bodies, international scientific international organization for standardization, that is ISO, they have all endorsed their safety. So safety is not a question as on today. Now, you know, once again, we would say that it's a very effective technology. Safety is not an issue. And to top it up, even environment is not an issue with this technology. It's environment friendly, prevents use of chemicals, leaves no harmful residues, no release of toxic effluents. There is no or a low water and carbon footprint of this technology. A very effective alternative to halogenated hydrocarbons used as fumigant, as I told you, that is methyl bromide or ETO. Phosphine, now which is widely used for stored products today, even in our FCI godowns. You know, it is it actually results in resistance in insects. You know, when you allow phosphine to be used as fumigant in godowns, many of the stored product insects, they actually become resistant to it. And there are 11 species of stored product insects which have been found to be resistant, and they have been found in 45 countries. It's quickly acquired from field population. Also, resistance is acquired from field population. But, you know, irradiation is very effective. Even if it's a resistant pest to a chemical, it can be irradiated and we can get rid of it. And insects do not develop resistance to radiation. So these are big advantages of using this technology. So I think that's the last slide of my lecture on this, and we will take this forward in my next lecture. So with that, I would like to thank you all for very patient listening. Thank you very much. Hand over to Dr. Tomar, please.
Thank you very much. Thank you, sir. Thank you. There is one question already. One question is, does the X-ray screening machines such as in airports have any effect on food items during screening? What is the cumulative dose range in this process?
Okay, that's a good question. That's a good question. If, in fact, we give that example that, you know, we expose, we let our food be exposed in X-ray machines, and, you know, there are no adverse effects. You know, if there were any issue of safety to food material, they would not have allowed it. The other thing is the doses in these X-ray machines are very, very low. So, you know, we won't even get any technological advantage out of these X-rays. So, you know, virtually there is no effect of these X-ray machines on airports on our food material, and it's perfectly safe. There are no issues.
Yeah, there is one more question. What is the decay time of irradiated free radicals? That means radiation produced free radicals.
Okay, yeah, there are a lot of studies available. So as I was telling you earlier also, there are two types of free radicals which are produced. There are short-lived free radicals and long-lived free radicals. And free radicals' life also depends on the type of food. So, you know, the long-lived free radicals are actually the radicals which are produced in bigger molecules, like, you know, with say protein, starch, or lipid, or in other, you know, molecules. But, you know, the short-lived free radicals are those which are produced in, for example, in water. Many of those radicals would be dying down in the course of time and will disappear. But some long-lived free radicals may remain, not in the food which has a lot of moisture, because if there is a lot of moisture and water, even you know, those long-lived free radical may also be extinguished. But you know, some if food is fairly dry, for example, bone, in case of chicken, there is something called hydroxyapatite radical, which is there in bone, which may stay. Or you know, we may have some radicals left in starch or in some you know, other coat part of a grain, and so these radicals may remain there, which are in very, very small quantities. And these long-lived free radicals have also been used for detection of irradiation treatment, because you know, otherwise you cannot detect irradiated food by smell or taste or change in texture. So for example, if you were to know whether your mango has been irradiated or not, so you know, you will not come to know from its taste or texture. You will come to know probably the stone weevil is dead. But still, if you want to know further whether it has been irradiated or not, then you can look for example, cellulose free radical, which may be there in the you know, coat part of its stone or you know, somewhere. So cellulose free, if you detect some free radical of cellulose, you may say that okay, this thing has been irradiated and this has not been irradiated. So that is how it is. I think there are no safety issues concerned with these things. And even if some free radicals remain there, many of these things go in for processing. And you know, for example, if we are using irradiated rice, what ultimately you will do is you will actually cook it in a lot of water. And during cooking, even if there is any radical which has remained there, will you know be extinguished. It will no longer be there. So ultimately, the food is safe, and there are no safety concerns. And these studies have been you know, done for all the bigger molecules. For example, what is the fate of say protein radicals, lipid radicals, or you know, so there are well documented chemical studies on this aspect.
One more question is there.
Yes.
How the irradiation time and dose is arrived to various type of food materials?
Yeah, that's an important question, and that's why food technology division is important, because you know, you have to actually check, you know, though we know in general like what are the doses required. For example, we know the quarantine dose is say around 400 gray, but we have to see, you know, whether our fruit will be able to tolerate this dose or not. Fortunately for us, when we worked with Alfonso mango, it was, you know, just a coincidence, because we were thinking in our laboratory experiments, we were seeing that above 250 gray or 300 gray, the mangoes were not very good looking, or there were some changes in the color. But you know, in a large setting, when we did these experiments, we were so lucky that you know, those mangoes were really good, and we were very happy that though US FDA was imposing 400 gray on us, you know, we could deliver that dose without impacting the quality of the material. So you know, supposing we know that dose required is around say 400 gray or 300 gray, but we may get another variety. For example, we may get a variety from Northeast, or we may get from Bihar. We may have to again test, you know, whether it can tolerate this dose. And that's why laboratory experiments are very important, you know, to test for every product and for every, in fact, in all agricultural produce, the varietal differences are very important. Also, you know, the besides varietal differences, the constitution of the food product, you know, how much moisture it has, whether it has some protective substances or not. So eventually you have to test it. Even for, you know, even in a commercial setting, you do a pilot study first, you know, whether it is able to get that kind of dose and tolerate it. So it's better to do a small study, and then we arrive at a, you know, dose and effect relationship. In fact, For example, in processed foods, it's very important. For example, chapatis, you know, if you were to store, we irradiate chapatis at different doses and look at their, you know, preservation part, how long they can stay, what are the storage conditions. Then, you know, the consumer tests are very important, where people would taste it. And then, you know, if something is not liked, then those doses cannot be used for, you know, irradiation purpose. If somebody rejects a chapati, which is given, say, 2 kilogray, then there is no use using irradiation for chapati at 2 kilogray. So, you know, everything has to be derived from these studies, which are done in controlled experimental settings.
One query, can you share the chart of required dose for agricultural products and the related calculations?
Related calculations?
Yeah.
No, there are, you know, this is derived in a different way. There is no standard format for it. Of course, for microbiological applications, for example, getting rid of pathogens and getting rid of spoilage organisms, we create something called a survival curve of the organism, which is, you know, on say x-axis we have for example we have dose which we give, and on y-axis we have the log survival numbers, and we see with the dose what is the reduction in, and then we come to know what is called D10 value, which means the dose required to kill 90% of the organisms. So this D is very important. And whenever we, you know, we have to, for example, deliver a dose for killing an organism, we use this D10 value. So in food industry, something called, say, 6D or 12D. So we'll give, say, 6 times D10. If D10 is, say, 2 kilogray, we may have to, say, for reducing the number of organisms from 10 raised to 6 to 10 raised to 1, we'll have to give 12 kilogray for that material. So this is how calculation is done for arriving at D10 value. For other things like, you know, killing of insects and all, there are other measures where, you know, we have LD50. That means lethal dose. At what dose the cells, the insects will be killed. 50% of the insect population will be killed, or 50% of the eggs will not hatch. So the LD50 criteria is used for mainly quarantine applications or for insect disinfestation. So these calculations are done in laboratories. So, and on this basis, we can calculate the dose. Incidentally, I didn't tell, but there is something called radiorization, which is called equivalent of pasteurization. So it's similarly, radicidation is equivalent of sterilization, where maybe in the next lecture I'll cover it up, but these are the terms which are used, you know, radiorization, radicidation, and radapertization, which is sterilization of food products.
There is one question. Can we irradiate dry coconut or copra to extend its shelf life?
Okay. This we have tried several. You know, there are issues with copra. Of course, my friends in FTD would vouch for it, because copra has some kind of oil, residual oil in it, and irradiation at higher doses may change, you know, may, because, you know, irradiation is actually an oxidizing agent. So we have to balance this oxidation and neutralize this oxidation. So maybe at lower doses, it may not change the flavor or storage properties. And also the storage temperature that you keep after irradiation. But, you know, if you just do irradiation of copra, you may land up with the rancid material after some time. So you have to take some proper precautions in irradiation as well as storage of irradiated copra.
Okay, sir. Thank you. I think that's all we have. Yeah, one more question is there. Any genetic mutation studies carried on Indian plantain, Musa paradisiaca?
Okay. Yeah, actually, you know, this our bioagriculture division, agriculture division, there is a group working on plantains. banana. So they have a tissue culture lab, and also they have carried out mutation part using tissue culture, banana tissue culture, or cells of tissue culture. So there are a lot of studies, and if you are especially interested, you can get in touch with our agriculture people.
I think we have missed the questions. So thank you very much, sir, and we'll see you on Monday 12th.
Yeah. Thank you very much, Dr. Thank you
very much. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, participants, bye-bye for now. We'll see you on Monday.